Welcome to the 4 Mile Circus, the official podcast of 4 Mile Circus, which is a media production and social media services company based in Brooklyn. Check us out at 4milecircus.com. That's the number 4, followed by the word Mile Circus. My name is Sean Mannion. I'm a writer-director in Brooklyn.
And I'm Nicole. I'm the other half of 4 Mile Circus and a writer-director-producer based in Brooklyn. On this podcast, we will talk to independent artists and media makers about their relationships with social media. If you like what you hear, please subscribe on iTunes or your platform of choice and give us a 5-star review. It really helps spread the word about the show.
We're going to be live streaming this and future interviews on Facebook as we conduct them. So like 4 Mile Circus on Facebook to be notified of future live streams so you can see all our mistakes and comment with questions for the guest. Some questions may even make it into the show.
On today's episode, we will be having part one of a 2-part discussion with Brooklyn-based rock band The Shondas about their new album Brighton, out September 16th on Exotic Fever Records. In today's conversation, we will be talking to The Shondas about social media and building and reaching an audience as an independent rock band. And welcome to the 4 Mile Circus podcast.
Thank you.
You're welcome. I'm Nicole, and Sean's right here too.
Hi.
And we'll try. I just talked over him. That's bad. You're not supposed to do that in podcasting.
That's okay. That's why we record on 4 different channels so that I can just cut you out whenever I want and keep myself.
I'm just going to announce that I'm moving my mic.
Oh, that's okay.
Thank you. That was kind of you. The other last time we recorded, I accidentally kicked the table and poor Sean had those headphones on and the look on your face was priceless.
That's okay. The headphones are never actually plugged in. It's an aesthetic choice. I can't hear. I just play by.
That makes me feel better.
I just go by the levels on the meter. Yeah.
In any event, this is the 4 Mile Circus podcast and I'm Nicole and that's Sean.
Hey.
And we are here in beautiful Brighton Beach on this hot, sweaty day with Eli Oberman and Louisa Solomon of My Family, full disclosure, and The Shondas.
Hello.
You want to say hello, Louisa?
Oh, hey. Hey. I wasn't sure if it was my turn yet.
Not talking over each other is going to be a...
You can talk over each other. Seriously, it's totally fine.
Okay. They are on
separate channels. Okay. All the mics are. So.
Yeah, I was just feeling like really moved by the introduction that...
It's really touching.
Of Nicole's family. Usually that's what I put on a resume.
Well, it's important.
Known for Nicole's family.
You're both, but it's notable.
And Eli, you're right.
Both.
We're both.
We're both.
Yeah.
We're all family.
We're all family here.
And Sean is all of our dad.
Yeah. I sometimes lie on my resume and say Nicole's family.
I can
gets
understand.
You far in life.
Probably explains why I don't have a job.
Nicole's family. Special they're skills. Like, Nicole's family.
And they're like, oh, those are special skills, but not that we need around this place.
Nicole might show up.
Oh, it's getting weird, guys.
Zinger.
Anyway, we're here to talk about, in the first part of this interview, we're going to talk about social media and building and reaching an audience generally as an independent rock and roll band. And then in part 2, we're going to talk about how you fund the rock and roll lifestyle. Specifically, we're going to be talking about some crowdfunding, but we're dealing with part 1 right now, which is building and reaching an audience. But before we get into all of that, I think Sean has a social media tip of the episode.
I do.
I can't wait to hear it.
It's super exciting.
We need tips.
We're going to talk about this new feature on Instagram stories, or as I think like people have been like referring to it, Instagram trying to be Snapchat. Yeah. Which I mean, I have to admit I'm not like a huge Snapchatter person. I've tried to do it. It often just feels like one more thing, but really from my experience with Snapchat, it does just feel like the scaled down Snapchat in that for those of you who aren't familiar, that basically means you can add photos or videos to your profile that disappear in 24 hours. You can save them to your own phone or whatever. But they won't be displayed on your profile anymore after a 24-hour period. And that's each piece of it will disappear after 24 hours. So if you post something at 10 a.m., it'll be gone 10 a.m. the next day. If you post something at noon, it will be gone at noon, and then we'll all be gone at noon. So it's really useful for creating content that, like, has a clock on, you know, the ticking clock sort of idea of scarcity. You don't have to.
It's evil.
It's evil, basically. Yeah,
it's like scarcity in our family is what you're saying. I'm sorry. Continue.
No.
We're here to tell it like it is.
Yeah, I mean, it's basically just if you want to share something, let's say you're making a film, you want to share like behind the scenes of it, but you really only want to share it with the people that you know are following you like consistently that are watching what you're doing every day. You can put it on there. They can see it, enjoy it, and then it'll be gone for the future, and you can reuse that content somewhere else. Or if you're a rock and roll band and you're recording and you don't need people to be able to hear like a part of a song, but you want to share part of the recording session, you could use it that way, share it there, and then it's gone in 24 hours. So it's a good way to like give exclusive stuff to a fan base. It doesn't really do like likes and comments or anything like that, but you can see who's watched it, each piece of it, and people can, rather than sending comments, they can send you a message through it. So in that way, it's like exactly like Snapchat. Like they're not even really trying to hide it. One of the only real difference that I think I noticed between it and Snapchat is that, unlike Snapchat, unless I've totally been using it wrong, you can add stuff from your photo library. As long as it's been added in the last 24 hours, you can add it to your Instagram story. So, for example, I used my Instagram story and the 4 Mile Circus Instagram story to advertise that we were doing this live. I didn't have to take another picture. I just took the promo image we made, put it in my photo library. It was able to upload it. But that also highlights another difference in that, or another issue in that you can't really edit the photo once it's in there. You have to kind of edit it beforehand. And when I first tried to do it, I made this landscape promo photo. When you try to do that on the Instagram stories, it gets cropped off. So I just turned it in the photo library. And it's a little bit nicer than Instagram in the sense that it's a full screen image, where Instagram is like, I can't even remember most of the time what the Instagram dimensions are, but
similar to Facebook Lives, I'd imagine.
Yeah. They're kind of square, but they're also, it's like,
you can get, square?
you can do wide ones, but they're like, it's still like the width dimensions are the same, but the height dimensions.
Goes,
yeah. Kinda. Yeah. Yeah,
it's a proprietary formula.
So I think, I'm enjoying the Instagram stories mostly because I don't want to have to use another thing in using Snapchat. And I already have like people who follow me inexplicably on Instagram. So I can hit them with basically the whole Snapchat aesthetic without having to start a whole new profile.
How distinct are the users on the two things? I mean, it's brand new, right? The Instagram stories thing just launched last week or something.
Yeah, it's a new feature that they added. Yeah, I think it must have been just last
week. It was just this
week.
We were
at rehearsal, and the one real millennial in our band, Alex, was like, oh, hey.
Shout out to Alex.
Hey, Alex, was like, Instagram is doing Snapchat now.
Yeah.
And so that's how we all found out.
I dislike it. Am I allowed to say that?
Yes, please.
But we're going to have to use it. I mean, we're going to start using Snapchat on this tour. And
we discussed that, in fact.
Yeah. Oh, on this show?
No. We discussed
your Snapchat
plans.
Well, we probably will.
4 Mile Circus social media training.
Thank you.
Yes. It was a wonderful social media training. But in any case, I'm wondering if we still will need to do that, or if we can just use the Instagram stories instead.
Well, we can talk to you about that after the show, perhaps.
Yeah. So that's not an on-air conversation, I'm sorry.
No, we can.
Well, can I say one thing about what he just said?
Yeah.
Can
I check your mic real quick? Can you just...
Mine or Nicole's?
Yours, Louisa.
Check. Oh, Louisa.
Hello.
Can Can you check the switch to see if it's on?
It's not.
It wasn't. There it goes.
Hello, hello, hello.
There you are.
Good thing I was projecting.
Yeah, no, I totally got you on the other one. Sorry about that.
But still. But I said so many important things. So you can hear me?
Super important. Yeah, I can totally hear you. Yeah.
I was only going to say, even though I was joking about creating scarcity for fans, because that's not actually what you're trying to do, but the thing that strikes me as really valuable about it is that sometimes we want to post stupid shit that's funny, but that we don't actually want for posterity, for all time, on the record, for exactly. industry people to come and see first when they come to our social media pages or
right,
whatever.
Right, right.
And it's like, the point you made is that your fans who are really actively tracking you, they're the kind of people who appreciate that you're in the grocery store on tour joking about what you're buying, but you don't actually want that to be what you lead with when someone's first trying to get a sense of who you are from your Facebook page.
Absolutely, and I think that's a perfect example of this sort of scenario in which this feature is actually useful. And
right.
I think, and to be fair, I think Snapchat's useful in the exact same way.
It's absolutely.
Just, it's just a matter of which platform you feel like using or which platform your fans are on or whatever.
I mean, I guess I would just say, when I said I hate it, I get the utility, you know, for example, us as a band. And that makes sense to me. And, you know, I think that using that at like distinction about the people who are really paying attention to you on a like very regular basis versus what you want to say for posterity is useful. I think the part of me that says that I hate it is just as like an individual user, not as in like how could we like successfully use this to promote the genres.
Aesthetics, not strategy.
Right. Like and we'll talk about this more when you ask us questions about social media, but like, I don't really like social media. I find it in general, just as a person, I find it to be burdensome and time consuming. And I'm not like, I don't love doing it. I don't love participating in it. And
brutal.
And Instagram is like the one social media thing that I actually enjoy. And part of the reason why I like it is because I like photographs, and part of the reason why I like it is because of the like utter simplicity of it, like the lack of some of the things about social media that feel like emotionally gross or draining to me about, you know, not likes, because obviously you can like things on Instagram, but about like the speed of engagement and like the way that conversations happen and like algorithms and all of that stuff. That's part of what I like about Instagram, is that it's like, great, I just like, it's just pictures that from people that I want to see their pictures in the order they posted them. I can look at them like, done.
Yeah.
You know,
oh, there's no algorithm for displaying on Instagram. It's only a matter of time.
They did just add one.
Yeah. I bet they did. Yeah. Yeah. Facebook owns them.
Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly.
There is one, because and it does
F that.
And I think it's based on like who you like the most often or something like that. Because I've definitely noticed like having something from like 8 hours ago being ahead of something that was posted like 5 minutes ago, on my feed, and which is annoying.
Well, that sucks. But also, it's like, okay, you can like something and you can comment, but you can't like comments and you can't comment on comments. Like, you know, it's
simple.
Just like the simplicity of it that just lets me look at photographs that I want to see, like that really works for me. And so the adding of, you know, going more and more in that direction is what I mean when I say I hate it.
I get that a lot. And I mean, the reason I kind of hate it is I just hate how anything that Facebook touches needs to try to become everything rather than just doing the thing that it does well.
Right.
That's what pisses me off about
it. Which feels related to what I was saying. Like, it just is what it is, and that's what I like about it.
Did they add the filters? Like Snapchat filters?
Yeah, they have. Well,
also,
you can draw.
Really limited ones.
There's not as many as on Snapchat, which is an advantage of Snapchat if you're into this sort of thing.
Not
if you want
Instagram filters.
Right. Yeah. Like
if you want to make yourself look like a bear.
Face.
Yeah.
You can't do that.
Make yourself look like a bear.
That's a generous description.
Yeah. It's super realistic.
But you can do it on Snapchat, save it, and then put it on your Instagram story.
That's true. That's true, you can.
Nothing sounds worse to me in this world.
You can spend all your life.
I agree with you, but I've seen it a bunch on there now.
In any event, you two, once upon a time, joined a social media website for the first time, I'm guessing.
What? As the band or as individuals?
No, as both. I'm curious about both. Both individually and as the Shondas, what were each of your first social media accounts? What was the platform and when was it? How'd you feel about it? Why'd you join?
Social media proper.
Yeah.
I mean, I had a Friendster account. It was my first account individually. Same. And I don't know if the Shondas ever... I don't think we existed then.
The first Shondas was MySpace. Yeah.
And I have to say, when I was preparing for this interview, I realized we still have a MySpace page.
Yeah.
Probably.
You sure
I haven't
do.
Looked at it
looked
in
at it.
1,000 oh, no. years, and I don't know how to log in. I'm sure I could get our password, but that's like a low priority task that should
probably
have happened before I broadcasted it, because everyone's like, what's on a Shanda's MySpace?
It's not that bad. I looked at it this week.
It's not that bad.
How is that
possible?
I mean,
it hasn't been updated. It's like a time capsule of 2009 or something.
It's a time capsule, but they also changed their format so much.
I know. The Justin Timberlake rebrand.
It no longer looks like GeoCities. I don't know what it is anymore.
I wish it looked like
no more sparkly backgrounds and automatically playing music.
Don't you feel like the speed at which culture recycles and whatever would have allowed MySpace to have a retro resurgence now
if
they had just left the original model with the backgrounds? Oh, it's not too soon for that.
Yeah.
But instead, there was the JT rebrand that it failed, right?
I mean,
Does anyone still use it? It still exists,
but I don't think anybody
uses it.
No,
but like, you guys are social media mavens.
Yeah,
and
nobody uses it for that. What it's more
it's
for
a joke.
Is they have articles like Sean Sotero, not this Sean, has written for MySpace, and other people I know, music journalists, have like written pieces for MySpace.
They have editorial content?
They did for a while. It's been a while since anyone I know wrote for them, so I'm not actually sure if they do anymore, but they were trying to shift towards being kind of like an entertainment website with a strong social media component as part of that thing I complained about earlier, of
everyone
trying
to be
everything.
Yeah.
I remember when they were starting to flag in front of like Facebook and all that and Twitter and all that. They were trying to like be like, no, where all the music is.
Right.
Because that was like the only
because
that was like the only group that really like everything clicked for was their whole setup. Yeah. Band pages. And that was really good for them. And then,
I think we must have left like stopped ever using it by 2009, I think.
Yeah, most people
2008,
did.
2008, 2009.
Most people did. Which kind of leads to the next question, which is...
Wait, Eli didn't answer.
I think I did.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, I also had a Friendster profile. Yeah.
You did?
I did.
I didn't vaguely remember this.
Not want it?
I was okay.
Did I make you get it?
I was sort of okay with Friendster. I refused to have a personal MySpace. You had a personal MySpace, and we had the band one.
That's probably there, too.
And then when Facebook happened, you were like, you have to, and so I did.
We have a long history of push-pull with social media for the sake of the Shondas.
It's this weird event of like these vestigial like social media accounts. Like Friendster went down. I remember when they took Friendster down, and I downloaded my whole Friendster profile because I had photos there.
Yeah. I know, I meant to, and I didn't because I was busy. Yeah. Then it ended.
And you missed your shot, and lessons learned.
But
all those
really
good
testimonials.
Oh, that's right.
Nice. They were testimony. I forgot about that.
That was the thing I cared about, actually, is there were some
nice
very,
things
like,
about me.
Yeah.
It was slam book. It was like, the prompt was like, write something nice about your friend.
Yeah.
But it wasn't, leading into my next question, it wasn't really set up so much for like promotion. It was very, very, very oriented towards like personal.
Right. Yeah.
Like friendship, you know, hence the name. And then MySpace came up. And I remember for me, when MySpace first started, I was resistant to joining it. I was just like, I don't need another thing. But then everybody was on it. And then I started, you know, doing like using it for promotional and networking reasons.
I don't even remember how you interacted with other people on MySpace.
That's what I was going to ask you, is how did you guys use it?
Use MySpace?
Yeah, as a band.
I think that you could, if I'm remembering correctly, there was not...
We need a fact checker.
Yeah, there was not like the division, like the way that Facebook has pages set up really differently than personal profiles. They were all sort of the same.
Until the rebrand, then they became music pages.
Right, and so I think that we would friend people through the band account the same way that you would as an individual. And then we would use it to like message people about shows. That's what I remember.
But like Facebook, actually you can mass message on Facebook now, but I think on MySpace you couldn't message more than one person at a time. It was very labor intensive. And in the early days of our fan database building, when someone expressed interest on MySpace, it was like so labor intensive to get data through that. But what I don't remember is how they engaged with us. Like, what was the public display platform, like comment equivalent?
There was on your profile, there were like comments,
mm-hmm.
like under where you had your top 8 friends or whatever.
It was, it was like
basically like a wall.
Yeah, but, I think it was called the wall, wasn't it?
Probably.
Yeah, because Facebook
started the wall.
Well, I thought so too. I think Facebook took it from MySpace.
I think
or
so.
Not.
And they
I don't know.
It was more robust. Like Facebook's version of that is much more robust, to use that word that I guess is the word we use as a vague catch-all. Of having a variety of features and functionalities and things like that.
It also, like, the other frustrating thing about it from a, like, band perspective was that, similar to the way that email addresses, sort of conventions around email addresses changed with Gmail to be, like, more like your real name, and that's with true. Facebook, that... Yeah. People's MySpace profiles were very rarely their real names. And so when you're trying, like when Louisa, as Louisa said, we were like using this to build, a fan database for ourselves so that we could actually be in touch with our fans. It was very difficult to match up people's profiles with the actual person that we might know and want to be able to tell about the band, because it was like, because of the way that pictures and profiles were named.
Because everyone was Sparkly Princess.
Exactly.
Right. And what we didn't anticipate well then, that we're more equipped for now, is that MySpace would inevitably fade out. And so on our database, there's probably hundreds and hundreds of MySpace URLs that lead nowhere, and there's no other identifying information connected to them. And they were a Shondas fan who we may or may not have their data captured elsewhere. But now, when we do similar kinds of data capture for fans on Facebook, we know that we need to get more forms of identifying information that the person consents to, but, you know, so that we can cross-check if they go off Facebook, which happens all the time. Hopefully, at that point, if they were a significant, you know, fan and were invested in keeping up with us, they have given us their email, and then they're on our email list. And when they come back on Facebook, we can always refriend them or whatever.
Yeah, that my next question was going to be about how you use social media now, and just context for the audience. Shondas have been together since 2006, right? Yeah. So this has been a decade of a social media roller coaster. You two have been on together.
Yeah, I would say the Shondas have basically been through the bulk of the history of social media know it. It's been a wild ride. But on the other hand, it was sort of a different band at that time. So,
yeah, but also, I mean, it was a different band. The band has grown.
So I sort of think of it as like, oh, that terrible band was doing a lot on MySpace.
Yeah.
Interesting. Shondas 3.0, yeah. 5.6.
Shondas have only existed since 2013.
That works for me.
Man, 2012.
People like Searchlights.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
2011.
Brutal.
Yeah. So how we use social media now?
How does new baby band the Shondas?
We're an up and coming Brooklyn rock band.
I'm 19.
Now. Yeah, I'm 21, and my first record's coming out, and I'm pretty sure it's going to be a giant hit. So it's going to be cool. We use social media a lot, and as individuals, we have different relationships to it. I think we all find it tiresome at the end of the day and labor intensive to use effectively. Although Eli has more of an aesthetic aversion than I do, just personally, to it in general. Mostly we use Facebook. We rely very, very heavily on Facebook. When people like our Shondas page, we monitor it and immediately try to contact the person through their page and ask if they'd like to give us their email for our email list. They get added to our database with whatever information we have, even if it's just their Facebook URL, so that we have a record of who showed interest. And certainly when people comment or share particular things that are relevant, we note that all in the database. But the main goal is to have a sense of where people live. And Facebook is good at that because people usually share their... the city that they live in on their profile. And that is important to us because we try not to send out a lot of email or a lot of messages, but to, you know, talk to people when we're coming to their city so that the information is actually relevant to them. So those are the identifying things that we're looking for, emails and their city.
And I'll add that just in terms of like different, you know, ways that people use it or protocols that they have around it. You know, I personally find it very annoying to be invited to a lot of events, either like through the actual event thing or through messages in somewhere that's 3,000 miles away from me. And so like, which happens
it feels
constantly.
Very impersonal.
It feels very impersonal, but it's also meant that I have started ignoring that altogether, which means that I'm also not looking at things that I might actually be interested in. And so I will say that I think that Luisa and I make way more of an effort than I observe other people making.
Not to put anyone down.
No,
it's very difficult to find
people
watching.
I'm not trying. Sorry, I'm not trying to shame people.
No, you're
just
good. Kidding, you're good.
I think a lot of people just invite everyone their friends
to every event,
which I totally respect and understand. But obviously, we're just making an effort in another direction.
Yeah, I it's something that I feel good about that we do.
Yeah,
that we really make an effort to. You know, if you live in San Francisco, we're inviting you to things in San Francisco, and that's pretty much it.
No,
we also use Twitter and Instagram, but they serve a less core function in terms of our band management. They're more fan engagement tools, and they exist, you know, within the scope of their own platforms. When we're on Twitter, it's great when people tweet at us and we tweet at them, and we are trying to be more engaged on Twitter because we spend so much time doing data capture through Facebook, consensual data capture. We haven't always gotten to participate as much on Twitter in conversation as is actually wanted and enjoyable. The truth is, when I spend some time on any platform talking to our fans and our friends, it's enjoyable despite the aesthetics and however you react to it. People are doing great work, and people are engaging with politics and art in ways that are super interesting. So I try to carve out a little bit of time just to participate in conversation, because that's what these platforms are there for. And I feel like that's better than just blasting promotional content. Of course, we also need to use them all for promotional content. And Instagram is kind of just a fun one, I think, because it's easier in a way. You don't have to really think as hard about how you're engaging with the existing content. Like, you can scroll through and like people's things, but it doesn't ask as much of you in your engagement the way that on Twitter, I think, you really look like a jerk if all you do is post your own stuff. And when people are having these really engaged conversations that you could be jumping into. On Instagram, I think you can just post pictures and occasionally scroll through and like other people's pictures. It's better, I think, to be engaged daily, but you know what I mean? You can get away with it. On Facebook, Facebook is like, sadly, a place I live. Like, I'm so rooted in Facebook, not because I endorse it. I mean, I think so much of what Facebook is doing is hideous. The algorithms and the policies and the what live streams they're allowing to be shown and all of this shit is terrible.
Yeah.
But so this is not an endorsement of Mark Zuckerberg and Facebook. Sorry, I know you're live streaming on Facebook now.
That's
fine.
We talk shit about Facebook all the time.
I'm sure you do. Freedom of speech. But they're
but they've succeeded in making them in making themselves completely ubiquitous in a way that it's like, wherever I am, that is open on my phone or on my like computer the same way that my email is.
But they same with me, it's always open. But Facebook, unlike Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, and other forms of social media that are actually popular at this moment, Facebook retains that old MySpace or Friendster profile section in much more earnest than a Twitter profile or an Instagram profile. Like, it is far less common for people not to share where they live, for example, on Facebook. Then on Twitter, people sometimes say, I live in Brooklyn, but it's totally voluntary and not as used. We get a lot out of that. And again, I emphasize that we really try to only communicate Shonda's stuff to people who are fans of the Shondas. It's not like we're trying to mine data out of Facebook, but when someone shows interest and that's there, it's really helpful. And in terms of tips for bands that are trying to build fan base, I cannot overemphasize what it is to be able to accurately track the people who are showing interest in you. And especially as compared to the sort of endless, labor-intensive waste that is outreach to a sort of generalized public. That is so labor intensive. Yeah. The making flyers in the way that we did in high school, the old school way. I mean, I miss those days, but making flyers and handing them out to random people at the cafe. I'm not saying you shouldn't ever do it. It can be valuable, especially if that particular cafe is a locus of, you know, cultural activity in your community or whatever. But broadly speaking, like, where you want to start is with people who already are interested in you and making direct asks of them to support what you're doing by spreading the word about your new album and your upcoming show to their friends. We try to use Facebook events and Facebook posting and our mass emailing, which we've been explaining is very connected to our use of Facebook. We try to use those things to incentivize show turnout, buying our albums, staying in touch with us, and people really getting their people, rallying their people to come and support us too. So if someone's a fan, make them an ambassador. That's the point.
Yeah, absolutely. It's kind of a positive side of this really nasty thing that Facebook does that probably most of us at the table agree is nasty, of their emphasis on legal names and profiles for an individual person with your real info, because they're Facebook's mining your data and they're far less vague on their notions of what consent means. I mean, yeah, we all accept our terms whenever they do a privacy update, but how many of us actually read that? I know I fucking don't. And we're all signing away our rights and we know that. But yeah, but like Facebook, more so than other social media platforms, really discourages having organizations using it, having bands use it, unless you're in this other class where you're paying, basically, right? Like, they don't show content from pages, whether it's the Shondas or 4 Mile Circus, to very many people who like those pages unless you're boosting them, because they're emphasizing so much we want real people with real names, which, as many
it's
of you,
transphobic and all of
yes
these other
it's transphobic, yeah. And fucked up for other people that for whatever reasons may not be like living their lives or living a certain part of their lives or whatever under the name that's on their birth certificate or ID. And it's another way that it fucks things up for people professionally. A lot of people use stage names, and that's right. The name they're operating under in the cultural sphere they're communicating in. They should be able to do that. There are other things in terms of whatever Facebook's like bullshit about like safety concerns, which they obviously don't care about if you see the way they deal with abuse and how their algorithms trap certain people. When I'm going on a tangent here about when targeted harassment campaigns on Facebook, which also would be nice to do something about. But a nice silver lining of their fucked up transphobic emphasis on real names, I was doing scare quotes and whatnot, is I guess it makes data capture easier.
Well, you know, probably this goes without saying, but the Shondas try very hard to keep our database current with whatever the preferred name of any individual is. And what we try to do is emphasize in our data capture city and email address.
Right.
And obviously there's a lot of updating that needs to happen with email address as well. But so that if people's names do change or if they're using multiple names, that's not some sort of a primary site by which we identify people, because that does sort of replicate that problematic.
Got it.
We do note what someone's current Facebook name is if we are putting their Facebook URL on our chart for data capture. But the other thing that's useful is by noting the URL, if someone does change their name or the name that they're using publicly, we are not solely relying on the name we had previously noted. We're relying on the URL, which usually doesn't change. It sometimes does. And also, again, as a backup, on email addresses, which you can search for people by within Facebook too. So there's a few different mechanisms by which we try to make use of the data that is in Facebook without playing into the things about it that we really hate.
Sure. That makes sense. Yeah. Beyond what you already shared, do you have other bits of advice for either like brand new bands who are just starting and trying to use social media, whether Facebook or other sites, to kind of like get a foothold into starting to like build and reach their audience, and as well as more established bands who maybe are just, you know, looking to figure out how to use this tool that maybe they haven't fully harnessed themselves yet? I mean, you talked about list building, database building, which I think is a huge for bands or any independent artist doing your own promotion. That's like got to be the linchpin of your outreach strategy, right, and is building that list.
I think for the truly up and coming, for the new band or artist or whoever it is who's trying to build a public presence for themselves and for whom fan base is going to be the driver of success on your own terms, I think that list building is the most important thing, and really thinking through what data actually matters and what data doesn't, so you're not bogging yourself down recording details that are kind of not to the point. And so you have everything from the beginning structured into the way that you track that data that you will ultimately want to sort by. And it's a really nerdy sort of thing to be thinking about when you're starting a band. People make fun of me a lot for being an Excel nerd. I like live in Google Docs, and we live in Google Docs quite literally. We have so many spreadsheets.
We all live in Google Docs.
Yeah, I think it's another, speaking of necessary evils and on the internet. But yeah, it's funny because I never thought of myself as being geeky in this way. And through both political organizing and trying to mobilize the Shonda fans early on, I started to get a mindset towards how to best capture and make use of data in an ethical way. And it's been a bumpy road to sort of learn that, because we've also had missteps, I think, where people were on the list and they didn't want to be. And so we try to be very, very attentive anytime someone requests not getting information to taking them off, which I think is another important thing in terms of making sure you are acting with integrity and representing yourself the way that you want to as you make use of these things. Because it can look bad. I mean, I think it can really come off, like self-promotion can come off very badly, and it's hard because it's a necessary part of being an artist and doing it in a way that is true to yourself and your brand and whatever. It's something that we put a lot of time into. But yeah, for a new band, list building is everything. Start with a list of your friends, people that you know want to support your work, even if they're just your parents, or, I mean, may you have parents who support your work. We don't all, but you know, if it's your parents, if it's relatives, friends, chosen family, whatever, get all those people on a list with their consent. I'd like to put your email on the list for this new project I'm doing. Do that. Send out an email about what you're doing and ask them to invite their friends to join the list. When you make a Facebook page, obviously invite all of your personal contacts to like it, and then personally message those people that are really championing you and ask them directly to help by inviting their friends to like the page or to tell their friends about you. And then as people like your page or email you to express interest, any method by which someone tells you they're interested, you should track that data, again, with their consent. But always be asking, may I add you to my list? Would you like to know when I'm going to perform in your city? And don't miss those people, because I will say in our early days, we had some really big fans who occasionally will remember them, and we don't know their names, and we just remember their haircut or that they were in Portland or whatever it was, and we don't have their data anymore. And hopefully they're out there following us, but they may have forgotten because maybe they were drunk at a house show in a basement one day, you know, saw us and loved us, talked to us for 10 hours and then forgot about it. And we were too stupid to get their email address before they walked away.
And I do, you know, I do think that trying to do things ethically is something that we've talked a lot about. And I think that while, like, I think the balance that we try to work with is, on the one hand, the ways that being like self-promotional can be distasteful, to do it and to receive it. Mm-hmm. And also wanting to be honest, you know? And so I think, like, when we're reaching out to people for their information, like Louisa saying, like, it's very, you know, I'm not just friending you and, like, you know, just saying, hey, like, let's be friends. You know, I'm saying, like, would you mind giving me your email so I can let you know when the Shondas are coming to St. Louis? Like, I, you know, and so it's really clear what you're, like, why you're asking them for what you're asking them
we
for.
We had to
so
learn that.
Yeah, we had.
We didn't know that at first. Right. And with very good intentions, I think we must have annoyed a lot of people, because what we did right was we were, I think, aggressive about our own work and labor and took it seriously. But what we did wrong was not always channeling that aggression in the most appropriate ways.
And that it's very uncomfortable to say that. It's not for me anymore because we do it, we've been doing it so regularly. But at the beginning, it was like, God, I'm too embarrassed to ask you this. Like, I feel presumptuous thinking that you might even ever want to come to a show, you know? And so it's hard to say that. And now I think we've realized how important it is to be more upfront and how usually people are not offended by that. And right. They'll just say no.
Or they'll ignore it.
You know, or they'll ignore it. And
I would add that when you're in the early stages of building, I think that evil or not, Facebook advertising is a worthwhile investment, specifically for people who are in bands. I can't speak to all these other areas that people are trying to promote on Facebook, but because of the specificity of their kind of crazy tracking of people's interests and stuff, which is absolutely problematic. I'm sure they're using it for marketing and all of these things in ways that we didn't understand we were consenting to when we signed up. However, from our standpoint, when Rolling Stone calls us, Riot Girl, Fuhrer, blah, 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 I can take that Rolling Stone quote and push it as a Facebook ad to people who note that they are interested in Riot Girl. And when I did that for just a few days the other week, it was like 300 new likes within those days, just as a result of that ad. And to me, that's absolutely worth the $20 or whatever you end up spending. It also does allow you to set a budget very low. So the point, the benefit point and the cost-benefit ratio isn't horrible. And you can experiment with it at a very low price point and figure out what kind of targeted audiences are most beneficial to you or worth your money, even if your budget is like $10.
I was just writing a blog post about exactly that and about how you can throw $5 at it and just like, or do $5 on one with like these demographics selected for your target audience.
Yeah, I do it all the time.
$5 on another and just track that.
I do think that the more money that you put in, the more shows you get and the more successful the ads tend to be in a way that doesn't directly correspond to what Facebook tells you. It is not a transparent process that you can feel good about in the way that I would imagine I would want to, but it does work. And if you, for example, can put together $100 toward a push just to get likes on your Facebook page as a band, I think that's a project that's really worthwhile. And like Nicole said, you can test, for example, different content, different markets, and different photos. When I ran that Riot Girl ad, I used two different photos of the band. One of them got like 5 likes. The other one got almost 300 likes.
What was the difference?
The difference was one photo was a promo shot of the current lineup of the band, which is a perfectly nice and adequate promo shot. People like it. But I guess it's not very exciting or Riot Girl looking.
I was going to say, your current promo shots aren't super Riot Girl in the popular imagination, I would guess.
I mean, I think what it more has to do with is that the popular photo was a live photo.
That's what I thought you were going to say.
And it specifically showed me, who's clearly female identified, singing and rocking out. And that may have connected to that text in a way that was more resonant for the people I had targeted.
Yeah, which you wouldn't have known beforehand. You might think like, oh, let's go with the more profesh photo.
Yeah, we look cool.
It makes perfect sense once we saw the results.
Yeah. Yeah. That's super interesting.
Sorry, obviously we could go on about this stuff endlessly. So just
I know. And speaking of like reaching out and connecting to an audience, like shifting arenas a little bit, you guys self-released your first album. You then signed to a small indie label, put out a second album, signed to a second small indie label that you've been with since then. That's Exotic Fever Records. Hi, Katie. Katie's great. Exotic Fever is great. You put out a lot of great music. So anyway, like it's interesting because you guys started in the mid-aughts, self-released, got the funding together, went into the studio, recorded it, distributed it yourselves. And that's kind of what a lot of indie artists are doing today. Like a lot of indie artists who used to be on labels are now choosing to self-release their own album, whether they're doing that through Bandcamp or they do a Pledge Music, like pre-buy crowdfunding thing to raise the funds to produce the album. And then everyone who crowdfunded gets it and it's available in stores or Patreon. A lot of musical artists are releasing material through that, like all different funding structures in terms of
both production, funding for production, and then distribution. And so that's kind of the context of my question. And what I'm curious about is, it's kind of a three-part question. Why you guys are on a label now, why you choose to do that, why you chose to sign to an indie label initially, and also what you've learned through all of that about self-releasing versus going with a label, pros and cons. Really big questions, so we can just talk about all of those things for a bit.
Well, we're definitely in a moment where, like, the culture and understanding of the role of the record label has already shifted dramatically from where it was even when we started, and continues to change and be sort of the way we think about, the way musicians and audiences think about the release of music is changing very rapidly, to make a very general statement that informs this conversation. And I think there was something actually funny about our experience that I don't think is very typical. At the beginning, when we first decided to self-release, we did something that I don't recommend, but it's not because it was self-release. So I'll explain. With our first record, we put a lot of money that we were able to put together through, to be transparent, through one band member's financial resources, someone who's not in the band anymore. And we put a tremendous amount of money toward a first record. I had come from a DIY self-releasing punk and Riot Girl background. Nicole and I ran a cassette label in the 90s. Two cassette labels?
Well, the second one wasn't cassettes, I guess. I take that back.
Oh, right. That was yours.
Was
Although
it?
We were on it. Yeah, I didn't co-run that with you. I know it feels like it.
Anyway.
We can discuss it later.
Yeah.
I don't really know. Anyway, Nicole and I have run.
Yeah, it was mine.
It was yours because I would email people pretending to be you on behalf of our band.
We would never do that now that we're more ethical.
Yeah, we're all more ethical. Oh, wait, the live stream crapped out.
I'm sure that matters a lot right now.
Oh, no, it's just low battery. I'm going to plug the battery in, but you can keep talking.
Hi, so we're continuing to live stream, breaking with low battery. Is it okay if I go on?
Yeah.
When we released our first album, I was coming from a mindset of DIY, and yet we were trying, Eli and I in particular, having come from a more DIY band, we were really trying to take this step toward a music career, and we felt it was very important to spend the money that it would cost to make a high quality album. We weren't throwing money away or anything. I don't mean to make it sound like it was a light decision. It was a very heavy decision and a difficult one, but at the level of band management, if I was advising a band in our position, I would tell them, if you have access to financial resources that will allow you to put out a really professional album, you probably need to wait until the band is ready to apply those resources most effectively toward putting out your music. And I don't mean that to be self-deprecating either. And I think probably someone did say that to us, and yeah, we didn't. They did. Listen to it, because it's really hard when you're very driven and very passionate about what you're doing. It's hard to know how to take those pieces of advice. They often come coded in misogyny and other kinds of, you know, talking down to you that you're reactive to. But the truth is, it was not really the right way to do it. But the fact that we self-released was a fine choice, and I think is a great and appropriate choice if you have the ability to do it. But all of these conversations have this incredible class-based and financial resource-based subtext. And when artists talk about their ability to do it themselves, the invisible, you know, the elephant in the room is, well, doing it yourself requires resources in terms of time and money. Certainly if you work or have a child that you have to care for, or responsibilities, family responsibilities or other, all of those things might interfere with your ability to do it yourself in accordance to a particular standard. So all that is to say, I love the idea of DIY, of which to me as a young person was very empowering and meant making use of what you did have toward realizing, you know, the dreams that you wanted to realize. And I think when we ended up at Exotic Fever, it was because Katie runs a label that really does that. It manages to both genuinely come from a feminist DIY ethos and history, you know, and background, and also to be a professional record label that is able to offer us things that we can't totally do on our own. in the middle of our career when we were lured in by another seductive situation with our fantasies of what major label support was going to provide us, we were really disappointed. It was an indie label, as Nicole said, but it had distribution through EMI. And for us, that felt like very tantalizing, like, oh my God, we can get these politics out there. We're going to be heard. We're going to be in these bigger record stores. This is going to open doors for us that we're incapable of opening on our own. But it comes at a great, great cost sometimes.
Well, and also, you know, as Louisa was saying about how DIY is, you know, it very much, it's limited by the resources that you have and that are available to you. And the idea of help, of financial and material help to do what it is that you're trying to do is very motivating. And even if you are not naive about the role that major and also indie record labels, you know, can play in bands' lives, like we've all heard, you know, these horror stories about, you know, they own you and they own your music and a bad contract that you didn't understand and you didn't think it was important to have a lawyer listen to it and, you know, like losing your artistic independence. And, you know, like we've all heard these stories over and over and over again. And yet when this is something that matters so much to you and you don't feel that you have the resources to create what it is that you're trying to create and someone is offering you concrete help to do that, that's very real, you know?
That record label, or that record deal that we had for a short time in the big picture of this band, it also allowed us to record, you know, and to actually make the albums without personal financial investment. Of course, you accrue debt to a record label when you do that, which you are, in most cases, then repaying through whatever sales or royalties come through from the albums that are produced in that process for the rest of your life, maybe never getting any money. But I think with regard to DIY, there's always this question of, well, what's the it? Like, you're going to do it yourself. What's the it? And the it for the Shondas at that time was something we could not afford or put together resources to afford. The production level that we wanted to use, you know, was high. It wasn't, I don't mean to make it sound like we had some fantasy of being in some high-powered studio with Rick Rubin or whatever, but it was like we wanted to capture the sound that we thought we had as well as possible and to be able to get the violin in particular to sit properly in the rock band, which is actually very tricky. There's some particular sonic challenges in this band, and you know, alighting on the right lineup and the right producer is what has made it possible for us to make the most of all of that. So anyway, it was expensive. And the idea of having someone take care of all of that was very alluring. And the problems that we faced were, you know, consistent with what you hear people complain about. Loss of control, you know, disagreements about the final master and what it should be like. And it caused us to pay our way out of the record label in the middle of production on Searchlights so that we could hire someone else to do the post-production. And that someone else was Tony Mamone, who's been our producer for the subsequent two records that have been much more successful both than anything we did prior to that. And both of those records have been released on Exotic Fever.
Yeah. I mean, I think one of the things that, you know, I feel like the conversation about how much the music industry has changed and continues to change, you know, I feel like we've been having this conversation for 10 years and it is still changing all the time. But, you know, I think it's very difficult. I think that there's this idea that, you know, with all of the technology now, we should be able to, you know, record ourselves on a laptop. I mean, I'm sort of exaggerating, but not entirely. And a lot of people do that and it sounds really great. But that doesn't work for us, you know, like that doesn't work for us, you know, some of the, especially with the violin, like Louisa was saying, and, you know, the vision that we have for what we're trying to make, like that's just not actually something that's possible for us. And so it does require finding ways and finding people who you know have genuine creative partnership with to figure out how to make that work. And, you know, Katie at Exotic Fever has, you know, has helped us enormously, and we do feel that we have, you know, common ground with her in terms of what it's like to work together as feminists, and the help that she gives us with, you know, with distribution, so that you can like buy our songs on iTunes. Like that's not, it's not nothing. Like that's not something we can just do ourselves. And so even though it's you know,
probably could now,
maybe we could now,
we couldn't actually at the beginning,
but even a couple of years ago maybe. But anyway, having that kind of support from an indie record label, even though it's not nearly at the scale of a major record label, has felt very meaningful to me, and we have felt really supported by her in a way that that is also like caring and rooted in our politics. So
yeah, the current arrangement is sort of a hybrid in a way. We are on a record label, but we also are very involved in the production labor and decision making and financial output toward the finished product. So it's, I wouldn't say it's a co-production quite, because it is on this record label, but our level of involvement is much higher than it would be if we were in a traditional record deal. It's not a deal, it's more a collaboration. And I think Katie would agree with that.
Yeah.
I would also say this whole conversation mirrors the conversation that young artists and bands have about PR. I don't know if that's somewhere else, but just to flag that a good thing about the ideas of DIY are that they remind you that there are always these cults of experts, this idea that there's someone out there who knows how to do this better than you in all of these different milieus, and that's often not true. And it also, you know, reifies this capitalist inequities all over the place, because you have to pay so much money to hire that PR expert to teach you how to do your PR and all of this stuff. Obviously, you can't do that without great financial resources. So our experience in hiring PR firms historically, early on in the band, was also negative, much like our experience with that record deal. And in a similar way, it felt very removed, like we were not a part of the process in the way that we needed to be for it to be effective. And when I took our PR over and we stopped trying to involve other people is when we really had success. And I attribute that to many factors, to aligning with Exotic Fever, to realizing Tony Mamone was a great producer fit for us, making better music, becoming better musicians, getting a better lineup for the band, all of those things. But also understanding how to target our PR work, how to target writers who might actually want to write about us instead of sending out press releases to a million random people, which I think is the parallel of throwing your show flyers out into the streets of New York. It's like maybe one in a million is going to respond to you, but really the way that you get this done is by research and seeking out the right people. And that's how on The Garden we were able to get Rolling Stone and Billboard and all of these more major press pieces. Then at this stage of our career, as we anticipate releasing Brighton, we actually made the decision to hire a PR firm again for the first time in, you know, I don't know,
6 years?
More, 7, 8 years, something like that, a long time. And it was with many recommendations and a lot of research. And I feel that the people we chose, Team Claremont, are really like Exotic Fever in a lot of ways, born out of a music scene that is supportive of artists and has a lot of DIY strategies going for it, even though it's a very successful, you know, PR company. So I would give the same advice about this to myself if I was going back in time. Don't waste your money on the high production value album when your music isn't ready for that, when your music isn't going to benefit from that. That's a sort of neutral way to put it. And don't waste your money on a PR firm when the thing you're promoting isn't ready for that level of promotion. You need to build your list, and then you can think about hiring a PR firm.
Yeah, I think that's all really good advice. And I think in the second half of our conversation, we'll circle. Sorry, I know. No, we're going to take a little break, turn the fan on.
Ooh,
get some water.
Fan break.
In 1 minute, or maybe 2 minutes. But I think, yeah, we'll circle back to some of that, especially stuff having to do with like production and distribution in part two of our conversation, where we're going to talk about crowdfunding primarily. And So that was great. But first, let's play a game.
Oh, it's game time?
It's game time.
Wait, can I just ask a question? Is under the table visible in the live stream?
No.
I think just like.
No, you can see it.
Like, can you see my underwear if I sit back? Do I need to think about that?
No, I think
because I am so hot.
Yeah. Sorry.
No.
Jess says no.
Thanks, Jess.
Thanks, Jess.
Okay. Good. Ready for a game?
Yeah.
It's not quite a game because it's the first. It's a game. So we'll do favorite things, which is what we do with all our guests for at least one episode. So this can be really anything. It can be television. It can be a movie. It can be
a feeling.
Food, feelings, shapes, colors, literally anything.
An experience.
My favorite thing is joy.
That's all right, really I'm done. I'm leaving.
Hey, Sean, what's your favorite thing?
My favorite thing. Okay, so
are we playing?
Yeah, we're playing. Yeah.
Oh my god.
Yeah, unless it's time. You guys want to go first.
But Eli's is definitely going to be Instagram stories.
Yeah,
there you go.
Yeah,
that's what it
sounded
like.
We all knew that.
So I had to actually write some stuff down on this one because of names. So I'm a big comic book nerd, and unfortunately, I don't as often read independent comics as I'd like. And I stumbled onto using the Comixology apps. They've got like a 7-day free trial for their unlimited section. And I finally read a comic that I've been meaning to for a while called Bitch Planet, which is a sci-fi, how did I write this down? Sci-fi patriarchal dystopia where women are sent to a prison planet for being non-compliant.
I've heard about it. When's it from?
It's from like last year.
Okay,
it's only like 8 or so issues in, maybe 12. But volume 1, which is like the first 6 issues, is available on the Comixology's Unlimited thing. And I read it last night. Like I was like, oh, finally I can read this. And it's a great commentary on patriarchy and just especially right now with the election, like the stupid fucking attitudes that come through about women and where people should be and how people should behave. And it's sort of this pushing it to this extent where literally people who don't behave right are sent to a different planet, which kind of becomes like
the best planet.
Kind of. I mean, it's a prison planet. It's sort of like genre-wise, it's sort of a women in prison book, but not as exploitative. I really, really enjoyed it. Even it executes the whole aesthetic of it, which has this sort of 1950s, 1960s vibe, like if that culture of misogyny had extended to the point where you could go to other planets. And is somewhat into the future.
Maybe Papa would like it.
Maybe. It kind of relates.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
But anyway, it's by Kelly Sue DeConnick and Valentin Delandro. And that's my favorite thing right now.
Sounds awesome.
Cool.
Is this like a problem for the mics that I'm fanning myself?
No, I can't hear.
Eli, do you have a favorite thing?
Besides air conditioning.
That can be. I think that's, if we're being honest,
let's be real. Yeah, air conditioning. But can I also say a book?
Yes.
You can say anything you want.
Book's been taken.
Since you're a rule follower, is it okay? But I thought of a rule that you might not have told us about.
So I am currently reading a book called The Paper Menagerie by Ken Liu.
Did Miller loan it to you?
Yeah. And
so good.
It's. Did you read it too?
Well, I worked on it. That's why he has it.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, produced it, or whatever. We made the audiobook.
I wouldn't call it sci-fi, but it's like sort of. It's sort of sci-fi light.
He's a sci-fi writer.
Yeah,
he's won sci-fi prizes.
But it's the like. I mean, I really like sci-fi. But it's like there will be often. It's a book of short stories. And there will be often sort of one element in a story that is not something that exists in this world, but it's not like an entire other, you know, race on another planet sort of sci-fi. But yeah, it's just I often struggle with short stories because I really like to be able to be in something for a very long time and really, but they are just so beautiful. And, you know, they're like these, like good short stories are, they're these little worlds that that even though they're, you know, some of them are very brief, you know, you feel like you had the time to be in those worlds. And a lot of them are, you know, sort of about dealing with and encountering otherness in some way, either, you know, being othered or often children of like dominant culture encountering an other and rubbing up against the ways that like racism or misogyny are confusing to a child, like because of coming from a child's perspective and being able to see the way that those structures are playing out in ways that don't make sense. Anyway, I think his like reverence for language and the way that he talks about books and language and stuff is also really beautiful. So I highly recommend The Paper Menagerie.
And if you prefer audiobooks, the audiobook of The Paper Menagerie was read by Joy Osmansky and Corey Brill, who are on Facebook, maybe watching right now. And I believe post-production was by Matt Cartsonis, who may also be watching on Facebook.
Oh, right, yes. Now. Hello, Matt.
Hello, Matt. shout out to my day job. My favorite thing right now is Family Ties. Oddly, because my second favorite thing is that my husband, Miller, Eli's older brother, has seen almost no American pop culture ever. So it's a slight exaggeration, but they were deprived of the quantity of TV that Nicole and I were raised with. And consequently, I get to introduce him to everything. And we binge watched Mary Tyler Moore, The Dick Van Dyke Show, Golden Girls. Anyway, somehow we ended up on Family Ties. Mostly I sleep through it. I'm pregnant, so I'm tired. I fall asleep. He watches like 10 episodes of Family Ties. But reliably in the morning, he gives me very detailed recaps of what happened. And he does it unironically and almost accidentally every day. And it's been happening since we started with, you know, another series. He would tell me what happened on Dick Van Dyke last night as though it were news. So anyway, I just wanted to share the news that Michael J. Fox is a brilliant young comedic actor.
Yes, he is.
But in truth, he's brilliant. And every day, Miller reminds me of that because he's encountering that brilliance for the first time. He also said that the parents remind him a little bit of your guys' parents. Because, you know, the premise is that the parents are lefties. They were like hippie anti-war protesters. It's like a white, I think Midwestern family in the 80s. And the parents were protesters in the 60s. And then Michael J. Fox is like a right-wing
young Republican
supporter
of
Reagan.
Louisa is recapping this for all of us because I, too, have never seen Family
Ties.
Right,
I'm sorry.
On account of us having grown up in the wrong family.
On the other hand, many Shonda's fans are probably too young to have seen Family Ties. So yeah, for them as well, it is a fine picture of 1982 through 7 or whatever.
Is it on Netflix or Hulu or both?
I think we're watching it on Amazon Prime, free with Prime.
Okay.
And if you don't have Prime, I'll just give you my login. So just message
just
me.
Say it
and
right
you can,
now on the podcast.
You can just watch all the Family Ties that you want. Or you can subscribe to Miller's Recaps.
Did you have something to say
that should
about
be a new
that?
Podcast.
It really should.
I would Recaps. Listen to that.
I would listen to that, too.
I do listen
to that, actually. Sometimes I get them also.
Sean Sotero and I were also watching Family Ties for a while and like lost the thread like a year ago. And so this is reminding
get
me.
Get back on it.
It was a good end of the day, go to sleep
right,
show. It's very like low key. Well, because there was this time where we were watching that and The Cosby Show. And then Hannibal Buress did his routine in Philadelphia that he'd done before. But this time it was on video and got disseminated, and the conversation about Bill Cosby, serial rapist, became part of the mainstream conversation again in a way it hadn't been. And that fucked up thing had happened where I had certainly repressed that, even though I had knowledge that people had accused him of these things. But like back in the 90s or whenever it was, it got filed away in my head as like, oh, but that wasn't really a thing like that in the way it did for a lot of people. It just fucked up. And then Hannibal Buress was like, hey, everybody, remember how this is actually a thing. And then we...
You didn't feel like watching The Cosby Show anymore is what you're getting to.
Yes.
Yeah.
I think many of us have had the experience of feeling no warm, fuzzy nostalgia for The Cosby Show at this point.
Yeah, even though it was a great...
Brilliantly acted show by many people.
Well, I was going to say a great show for, like, many. Going to sleep to because nothing fucking happens. It's like Cliff trying to find a place to read the newspaper, and that's the whole episode.
It's pretty soothing.
Now, hold on. I think that's a little reductive. Sometimes he's trying to eat a sandwich.
That's true.
Sometimes he delivers a baby.
Sometimes he doesn't. Sometimes that baby is a sandwich in a dream sequence. Whoa. Does nobody
think I know
that?
I think I know that episode.
A hoagie?
That's where all the men deliver like hoagies, and one has twins, and it's like a hoagie and a 2-liter bottle of soda.
I want a hoagie and a 2-liter bottle of soda right now.
That sounds so good right now.
We can,
but you know what's good?
Soda.
A Different World.
A Different World. It really holds up.
But your favorite thing is?
My favorite thing is no explanation needed. The Rogue One trailer. And we should have a conversation off air about Rogue One. And seeing it.
Yes, we shall. What's the release date? I'm sorry,
like
I don't
December.
Know.
December.
I know, but
15th.
That's my due date. That's why I'm asking.
That's why I'm
just in the theater. That's fine.
Seeing as how
that's
I legit. Miscarried while watching Star Wars Episode 7.
Well, I was thinking it's kind of, you know,
it will be cathartic if I can watch Rogue One as I deliver my baby.
Well, I was thinking, I actually had, and we can cut this from the podcast, Sean Satara and I had a whole conversation last night about this, because I was saying I'd be up for going with an understanding that if you go into labor, we all just leave.
Wait, is it really coming out December 15th?
I think so.
I can look it up. Hold on.
Please look it up.
I mean, this is inquiring minds want to know. My future child wants to know.
What a story that would be.
One into labor.
Actually.
December 16th.
December 16th.
So deliver the
baby. So I'll be in and out, and then we'll go. Yeah.
Yeah. Just deliver the baby and then go.
Yeah, I've got a nursing dress. It'll be fine.
It will be fine.
Yeah.
I'll just eat and sleep while we're in the movie.
Mm-hmm. We can go to a couple showings so you can see the parts you missed because you were asleep. Yeah.
Okay.
And on that note, where can listeners of the 4 Mile Circus find you two online?
Oh, we're to that part now?
We're to that part, and then we're going to take a little break.
Oh, and then there's
and then
more.
We're going to, the second part will be shorter.
I was actually going to say, since you gave me that platform, since we didn't say it at the beginning in any way, the Shondas are a rock band based in Brooklyn, New York. We're going on a national tour. You can cut this out if you want, but
yeah,
we're going
we'll
on a national...
We will, just so you're relieved, we will do an intro that we'll record later
to
stick on explaining who you are.
I was wondering about that.
Throw everybody into the pit with our conversation.
Well, then I guess I can stop this then.
You can do it.
We have an album coming
thing.
Out in September. We have a tour coming up in August and September.
What date is your album coming out?
September 16th. Also the birthday of engineer Richard Cellino. Shout out to Richard on Facebook.
Richard.
I wrote about that
I
in
know,
the scene.
I saw.
What was the question? Social media. Where can you find us? Well, facebook.com/theShondas. Shondas is spelled S-H-O-N-D-E-S. You can also find us at www.shondas.com. Same spelling, S-H-O-N-D-E-S.com. I think those are the main places you can find us.
Twitter and
online.
Instagram.
I don't know the handles offhand. Yeah, we are
just
on Twitter
search.
And Instagram.
The Shondas, yeah.
If you search for The Shondas, spelled S-H-O-N-D-E-S, on any of those platforms, you'll find us. You could also friend us on Snapchat because we have a lot of intention to send you Snapchats on our upcoming tour. And I will just give you a teaser. We are planning to report live every night from the green room. How many dicks are on the wall of this green room?
Yes.
So if you want to know how many penises have been graffitied on the walls in the dressing rooms around America, you should follow us on Snapchat.
It could be one.
Breaking news.
Or 10 or 9 or 25.
Yeah, I've seen all of those options around the world.
Any number of dicks is how
many. I will actually turn on my Snapchat notifications.
Just for that?
Just for that.
I will say the likelihood of zero is very,
very unlikely.
Low, but it could happen.
But you could occasionally only see one dick on the wall.
And yeah. You know, if there is zero, you can always fix that.
True.
We're not usually participants in that, but you're right.
You
we
know,
could.
We could.
It's hard to feel comfortable in a green room with zero dicks on the wall. So.
Well, it feels so posh, you know?
I know,
if
yeah.
Like, where are we? Is this a palace?
And then, which fork am I supposed to use?
Right.
Are we at the plaza?
Am I dressed well enough? There are no dicks on the wall.
So basically, if anybody listening or watching is in a green room and there are no dicks on the wall,
please
and
draw them.
Might be a place that the Shondas might play. Please draw one, and you can leave a note saying, I drew this for you, and it won't be creepy at all.
If there's no dick on the wall, just draw a castle and be like, welcome to this cleanly, posh palace. Sit down and have a cocktail. Service is coming. Your caviar is on the way.
Right? No. Draw dicks on the wall.
Sketch a delightful bird.
I'm going to admit it. I don't enjoy the dicks on the wall. I find them yucky. Yeah, I mean, it's part of my life and has been for 20 years now, but I don't like it.
Let's just wrap up real quick. People can find us at 4milecircus.com, facebook.com/4milecircus. We're Twitter and Instagram. We are 4milecircus. And we will talk to you all again soon.
We'll talk to you all again too with part two of our conversation with the Shondas.
If you like what you heard, please subscribe on iTunes or your podcast platform of choice and check out other 4 Mile Circus services and projects at 4milecircus.com, as well as 4 Mile Circus on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Watch our first VOD release, Nicole's award-winning feminist phone sex horror comedy Small Talk, at 4milecircus.com/store.